wish you were here, but you're not, cause the drinks bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Toast to the ones here today. Toast to the ones that we lost on the way, cause the drinks bring back all the memories. And the memories bring back you. Without you, my friends, and I'll tell you all about it when I see you again. We've come a long way from where we began. Oh, I'll tell you all about it when I see you again. When I see you again. But in the end it's right. We hope you have the time of your life.
I can almost see it, that dream I'm dreaming, but there's a voice inside my head saying you'll never reach it. Every step I'm taking, every move I make feels lost with no direction. My faith is shaken, but I gotta keep trying. Gotta keep my head held high. There's always gonna be another mountain. I'm always gonna wanna make it move. Always gonna be an uphill battle. Sometimes I'm gonna have to lose. It ain't about how fast I get there. Ain't about what's waiting on the other side. It's the climb. Struggles I'm facing, the chances I'm taking, sometimes might knock me down, but no, I'm not breaking. I may not know it, but these are the moments that I'm gonna remember most. Yeah, just gotta keep going. And I gotta be strong. There's always gonna be another mountain. I'm always gonna wanna make it.
this world seemed so big, and everything seemed so out of reach. The sky is high and the walk is wide. You just don't know what you've got yet. It's in the palm of your hand. It's right in front of where you stand.
Take with you.
I know we'll meet again. So let your life begin, 'cause this is not goodbye. It's just I love you to take with you until you're the same. It only matters where we're going. It never mattered from where you came. It only matters where we're going. It never mattered from where you came. And I will tell you where I'm your order, how I love you just the same. It only matters where we're going. It never mattered from where you came. It never mattered from where you came. It never mattered from where you came.
Good morning, and welcome to Emmanuel High Church. I'm so happy that you've joined us in spirit from wherever you are for a time of worship today. This is Sunday, June 14th, graduation Sunday. First, for those who are joining us for the first time, a few housekeeping rules. Your microphones are muted to cut down on confusion, but please still use your voice to participate in this morning's worship. Next, at the bottom or possibly at the top of your screen, you should find a chat box. And you need to click to open it. And that's where you will type in any prayer requests that you might have for later in our worship time. This week, as in all our weeks using Zoom, we will be reading out of our own Bibles. So take a moment to fetch your Bible if you haven't already brought that, and a candle as well. Our scripture reading this morning is Psalm 100. And from the book of Genesis, chapter 18, verses 1 through 15. Our hymns are, Morning Has Broken, I Was there to Hear Your Morning Cry, and Blessed Be the Ties That Bind. After the service, you're welcome to grab a cup of coffee and hang out for our coffee hour to chat and catch up. And we will unmute your mics at that time. And as a reminder, I hope you'll meet us at the church parking lot at 1 p.m. this afternoon for our graduation car parade, where we'll be passing by the homes of our three graduates. And now let's move into our time of worship, shall we? Let's place our right hands on our hearts as we usually do, and our left hands on our bellies. And breathe in to the count of four. And out to the count of more than four. Breathing in the presence of God. And breathing out any stress or anxiety. Breathing in God's peace and releasing any worry. We're reminded that as we move through these days of reflection and contemplation, that God is with us, ever drawing us near to the spirit of oneness and love. So now's the time, if you have a candle, take a moment to light it as I light the candles here on our altar. We remember that the flame represents the light of Christ and reminds us that Christ, as the Holy Spirit, is always with us and also within us. The candle also reminds us that regardless of what we were doing just moments ago, we've now entered into a sacred time. We're never truly alone. Christ is here now and as we worship and always within our hearts. Will you pray with me? We gather this day, O Lord, to acknowledge a threshold moment, a thin place between what's been and what's to be, between what's been studied, learned, and accomplished, and all the more there is to study and to learn and to do. It's so very good to mark growth in celebration. And then so very good as well to celebrate having further to grow, to note a mile marker on a longer way, and to take joy in both the distance traveled and the distance yet ahead. Bless this liminal time and space and those who stand in the threshold looking back and looking ahead. May it be with a sense of both gratitude and anticipation. May it be with an awareness of how we grow our lifelong with our whole person, our minds, bodies, spirits, and emotions. And may it be with a profound sense of what it means to place our way where we've been and where we're going within the larger way of our Lord Jesus. Amen. Let's take a moment now and join in to our introit.
Please join me in the call to worship. Praise the Lord with all that you have.
Praise and trust in the Lord with all your heart and soul.
For God is with us throughout all our lives.
God's loving presence surrounds us and comforts us in times of trouble.
Rejoice in the Lord at all times and all places.
For God was steadfast and loving to all.
Thank you.
Please join me in the opening prayer. Heavenly Father, as we hear the names of our graduates spoken aloud today and celebrate their accomplishments, let us also hear your voice calling each one present to receive a word of purpose and direction in life. We celebrate our students finishing a chapter in their history. May they continue from this day and this place to create outstanding stories that surround them every day and in all places they may find themselves. And so, with friends and family who have gathered to encourage and support these graduates, we welcome your presence, O God. For you are the one who has anticipated this moment from the beginning of time. Amen.
God is reaching out for you today. God offers encouragement and strength out of God's great love for you. It is a free gift continually given by God. Thanks be to God. Hallelujah and amen.
I hope the days come easy and the moments pass slow, and each road leads you where you wanna go. And if you're faced with a choice and you have to choose, hope you choose the one that means the most to you.
Hope you still feel small when you stand beside the ocean. Whenever one door closes, I hope one more opens. Promise me that you'll give faith a fighting chance. If it's cold outside, show the world the warmth of your smile. But more than anything, I hope you dance. I hope you dance. I can almost see that dream I'm dreaming. There's a voice inside my head saying, you'll never reach it. But I gotta keep trying, gotta keep my head held high. My wish for you is that this life becomes all that you want it to. Your dreams stay big, your worries stay small. Getting to, I hope you know somebody loves.
This morning we honor our high school and college graduating seniors, and I'm sure that you, like I, could not be prouder of the three outstanding young women embarking on new adventures this morning. The talented and compassionate young women are a credit to our entire church family. Melody King, daughter of Greg and Kelly King, and granddaughter of Bud and Anita Warren, is going to attend the University of Akron and will be studying in integrated language arts with a plan to become a high school teacher. Becca Painting, daughter of Brad and Betsy Painting, is graduating from Wadsworth High School and planning to attend Ohio University to study child psychology. Jamie Sammons, daughter of Brian and Andrea Sammons and granddaughter of Irv and Jerry Wagner, is working at Target for the time being, where she's been employed for the last 3 years while attending Kent State University. Her bachelor's degree is in integrated language arts, 7th to 12th grade English, and she hopes to get a job as a teacher. Until then, she will work at Target and substitute teach. She wants later to pursue her master's degree. And now will you join with me in the litany for our graduates? We are gathered together to celebrate the accomplishments of all the recent graduates among us.
We give blessings to you for all that you have achieved and many more achievements yet to come.
One part of your life's journey is complete. You will prepare to begin another phase that will take you to unimaginable places. As you prepare for your next journey, we hope you will remember the ones you leave behind who have loved and supported you throughout the years.
We give you blessings of goodwill and love as you journey forth into the world. We thank you for the laughter and fellowship that you have shared with us, and pray that as you begin your next journey, remember the times that we have all shared with you.
Use those memories as a beacon to guide you on your path. Don't look back longingly, but continue forward, using your memories to create a new path.
We pray that God will give you strength and determination to develop new relationships that will help to strengthen and sustain your faith.
Because we are made in the image of God, we have been blessed with free will to make choices and decisions.
We pray that you will make wise and rational decisions, always turning to God for help. God hears, God listens, God is always with you. Do not forget that. Always keep in mind that God is around, and if you turn to him, he will guide you.
Just as Jesus commissioned the disciples to go out and spread his word with the world, so do we commission you to do the same through the way you live your life. Always keep Christ in your heart.
We send you forth with all our love, all our reverence, all of our perseverance, and all of our support. Strive for only the best rewards that life has to offer you, and may the love of Christ shine through you.
Christ is the light of all people. Let him shine in you during tough times, and always keep that light alive.
Let Christ's light shine always. Thanks be to God.
During our Zoom worship time, we have been setting aside a few moments each week to learn more about our Bible from the Bible Project folks. This week talks about the use of character in the Bible. I will send out a copy of this video later on today for those of you who would like to view it in more depth. But right now, let's take a look.
We're talking about how to read biblical narrative, or in other words, how to read stories.
Right, and one of the main ingredients of any good story is characters who encounter conflict and then have to overcome it.
Yeah, let's talk about characters. In most stories, we quickly identify with characters because, just like them, we're in our own story having our own conflicts that we need to overcome.
Yeah, and good stories have characters with relatable struggles. We can watch them react to these challenges in different ways, and we get to see what happens as a result. Through characters, an author can show us their view of what it means to be human. The Bible's no different. Biblical stories use characters as a mirror so we can see ourselves and discover our own human nature in the reflection.
The thing about characters in the Bible is that they can be hard to relate to. I mean, often there's very little detail given about them.
Yeah, biblical authors develop characters differently than modern narratives. They prefer to communicate a lot through minimal detail. For example, we rarely hear what people look like in the Bible, but when we do, it's crucially important for the story.
Like we're told that Saul is tall, and David was kind of a runt.
And these become images of their moral character. Saul's height matches his love of status and power to impose authority, while David humbly accepts his low status and allows God to exalt and deliver him.
So people's physical appearances are symbolic.
Yeah, very often. Like Esau's hairy body fits his animal-like behavior, and Jacob's smooth skin matches his deceptive, slippery nature.
What other clues do we get about biblical characters?
Well, often people's names symbolize their role in the story. Abraham in Hebrew sounds like father of a multitude. Jacob means deceiver. Ruth means refreshment. And Saul, his name means the one asked for. He's the flawed king that the people requested.
So by packing all this meaning with very little detail, biblical stories can do a lot in a little space.
And they even leave out things that modern readers want to know about these characters. Like they rarely come out and tell us people's thoughts or motives.
Right, like when Moses saw an Egyptian beating an Israelite, he kills him on the spot. But why? Was this righteous anger, or did he just lose his cool? And was it okay with God that he did it?
Yeah, we're not told. Because biblical authors usually avoid giving moral commentary. They would rather have a character's words and actions reveal their motives, and then leave us to judge their behavior by seeing the consequences. So in the case of Moses, this murders the beginning of a pattern of his anger getting the best of him with bad results. This choice forces him to run and hide in the desert for 40 years.
So it was a bad thing. But he does meet his wife out there, so it's a good thing?
Exactly. It forces you to ponder. Through all these techniques, the biblical narrators keep their stories compact, memorable, but also engaging.
But seriously, was Moses being good or bad? Right? Like in classic stories, there's always a good guy and a bad guy, some admirable hero who faces off against some horrible villain.
Sure, and simplified characters like that are helpful for teaching children there's such a thing as good and evil. But the Bible's not a children's book. Its characters are very complex, a mixed bag of good and evil, just like us. There's hardly any flawless characters in the Bible.
What about heroes of the faith, like Abraham or King David?
So you mean Abraham, who used an Egyptian slave for sex and then lied about his wife two times to save his own neck? And David, the man after God's own heart, who sleeps with another man's wife and then murders him? These stories are anything but simplistic. They offer us realistic portraits of compromised people like ourselves. The real surprise is that God keeps working with them despite their failures.
So just because a person's called by God or wins a battle, becomes successful or wealthy, doesn't mean the biblical author wants me to act like them.
Right. It would actually be really dangerous to imitate most biblical characters.
True. But there must be something admirable in biblical characters, something I can imitate.
Absolutely. Pay attention, and you'll notice that most biblical stories highlight the moments when characters fail or come to the end of themselves, and then they choose radical trust in God's grace and wisdom. It's in these stories that the authors show us how to be a human who truly pleases God through humility and surrender.
Yeah, the fact that God stays committed to biblical characters is a profound statement about the patience and love of God, who is also a character.
Right. And by studying biblical characters, we can observe our own worst tendencies on display. And we see time and again God's gracious response that will see this story through to the end. Hey, you guys, we hope this video
Our first lesson is from the book of Psalms, number 100. Listen as the Spirit speaks to her church. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come to his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is he that made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him, bless his name, for the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. May God bless the reading of the word.
So it was helpful for you on how to understand characters.
Our second lesson this morning comes from the book of Genesis, chapter 18, verses 1 through 15. Listen now for the word for God's people. The Lord appeared to Abraham by the oaks of Mamre as he sat at the entrance of his tent in the heat of the day. He looked up and he saw three men near him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent entrance to meet them and bowed down to the ground. He said, "My Lord, if I find favor with you, do not pass by your servant. Let a little water be brought and wash your feet and rest yourselves under the tree. Let me bring a little bread that you may refresh yourselves, and after that you may pass on since you have come to your servant." So they said, "Do as you have said." And Abraham hastened into the tent to Sarah and said, "Make ready quickly 3 measures of choice flour, knead it, and make cakes." Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to the servant, who hastened to prepare it. Then he took curds and milk and calf, and the calf that had been prepared, and set it before them. And he stood by them under the tree while they ate. They said to him, "Where is your wife Sarah?" He said, "There in the tent." Then one said, "I will surely return to you in due season, and your wife Sarah shall have a son." And Sarah was listening at the tent entrance behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in age. It had ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of women. So Sarah laughed to herself, saying, "After I have grown old and my husband is old, shall I have pleasure?" The Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh and say, 'Shall I indeed bear a child now that I am old?' Is anything too wonderful for the Lord? At a set time, I will return to you in due season, and Sarah shall have a son." But Sarah denied, saying, "I did not laugh," for she was afraid. But he said, "Oh, yes, you did laugh." This is the word for God's people. May God bless all who hear it who keep it and who share it. Will you pray with me? May the words of my lips and the meditations of each of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Today, we stand with you, Becca, Melody, and Jamie, at a major threshold in your life, your graduation, sometimes called commencement. When I was younger, I thought the word commencement meant ending, and that's an understandable mistake. After all, people make commencement speeches at the end of high school or college. But later I learned that commencement actually means beginning. And since the beginning of time, children have always been the heart of a faithful community. We hear over and over again in the book of Genesis God's promise to Abraham that he will build a great nation and indeed a world from Abraham and Sarah's offspring. Even when it seemed impossible, God blessed the couple with a child, and just the thought of it brought joy and laughter to Sarah's heart. A child would be born, and through him, the world would grow and prosper. Psalm 127 tells us, "Behold, children are a heritage from the Lord, the fruit of the womb, a reward. Like arrows in the hands of a warrior are children of one's youth. Blessed is the man who fills his quiver with them." And what was true in ancient times is still true for us today. We cherish you with joy and celebrate with you as you embark on your new journeys. Khalil Gibran, in his famous book, The Prophet, wrote this poem about children. "Your children are not your children. They are the sons and daughters of life's longing for itself. They come through you, but not from you. And though they are with you, yet they belong not to you. You may give them your love, but not your thoughts. For they have their own thoughts. You may house their bodies, but not their souls. For their souls dwell in the house of tomorrow, which you cannot visit, not even in your dreams. You may strive to be like them, but seek not to make them like you. For life goes not backward nor tarries with yesterday. You are the bows from which your children, as living arrows, are sent forth. The archer sees the mark upon the path of the infinite, and he bends you with his might, that his arrows might go swift and far. Let your bending in the archer's hand be for gladness. For even as he loves the arrow that flies, so he loves the bow that is stable. And so we send you forth as arrows from our bow, not back to your old life as you've known it, but forth to a new life, one in which you now will begin to create your own future, your own ending, and your own meaning along the way. And in that vein, I'm not going to attempt to tell you what to think or what to do as you go forward, because I have the faith that if you follow the path where Jesus leads, you're going to be in good hands. But instead, I've spent this week seeking advice from millennials just a little bit further down the road of life than you. And today I lift up a few of the things that they told me for your consideration as you decide how you will craft this new life that you and Jesus are about to embark on. First, live each day as if it were your last. Ask yourself, if today were the last day of my life, would I want to do what I'm about to do today? And whenever the answer is no for too many days in a row, know that you need to look for a change. Remembering that life is finite may be the most important tool you'll ever encounter to help you make big choices in life. Because almost everything, all eternal external expectations, all pride, all fear of embarrassment or failure, these things eventually fall away at the end of life, leaving only what's truly important. Choose to do what makes your life meaningful. And following that thought, don't be afraid to fail. Ultimately, we all have to decide for ourselves what constitutes failure, but the world's quite eager to give you a set of criteria if you let it. Failure is the best teacher around. It teaches us that there are blind alleys in life, routes that are better not taken. The knowledge that you have emerged wiser and stronger from setbacks means that you are, ever after, secure in your ability to survive. You'll never truly know yourself or the strength of your relationships until both have been tested by adversity. Such knowledge is not a burden, but a true gift. For all that it is painfully won, and all that it's been worth more than any qualification you'll ever earn. Life is a marathon, not a sprint. Failure builds strength, humility, and fortitude for the things that are really worthwhile in life. Remember that even Serena Williams wasn't a tennis champion overnight. Many, many balls were hit into the net before she won 23 Grand Slam titles. Second, stay flexible. You've already learned a lot from this pandemic about disappointment, I know. But don't let it discourage you, and don't be afraid to try new things. The diversion set before you on your path might turn out to be the very opportunity God is putting before you to try. New careers, friends, and lifelong hobbies have often emerged from disrupted plans. Next, make your dream big enough to include others. Remember, you didn't get where you are on your own. Your parents, your family, your teachers, coaches, community, and yes, your church were the bow that's sending you forth. And others will always be there to help too. Network and collaborate with students and coworkers along the way. Don't be afraid to stop and ask for help and directions. And remember, others will follow on the path you lead. Take time to give a hand up to someone else in need and to build a life worthy of following. And finally, don't let others define who you are. Social media can be both a blessing and a curse. Both compliments and criticism should be treated like chewing gum. Take them, chew on them for a while and see if there's any truth to them, but then spit them out. But don't swallow, for they are merely pointers along the way and not the ultimate truth about you. Only you and God can decide what's true about yourself. And even then, what is true is only true for you as long as you choose it to be true. We each are constantly creating who we are and who we'll be in the future. My wish for you is to follow Christ all the days of your life. Listen for his voice. Follow the path he's laid down, his life to show you. And may your dreams always be big and your worries be small. And all of God's family joyfully says, Amen.
It's been a long
the road. Time grabs you by the wrist, directs you where to go. So make the best of this test and don't ask why. It's not a question but a lesson learned in time. It's something unpredictable, but in the end it's right. I hope you had the time of your life.
Had the time of my life. No, I never felt like this before. Yes, I swear, it's the truth. And I owe it all to you.
I had the time of my life. No, I never felt like this before.
Time of my life. I hope you had the time of your life.
Our loving God has called us into the mission fields around us to show our brothers and sisters what His love looks like. May the gifts we offer today be fuel for the fire that burns within us, igniting our desire to be your workers. Let's remember to send our tithes and offerings to the church through the mail or PayPal found on our Facebook page.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Praise Him, all creatures here below.
Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Will you pray with me? Life swirls around us, O God. So many things are happening in our lives, in our neighborhoods, in our country, and in our world. We can be so easily distracted and overwhelmed by the needs and the difficulties. Remind us again that you are with us and have plans for our welfare and not for our harm, to give us a future with hope. Give us strength and courage to live into the future you have planned for each one of us, Lord. Place your healing hand on our hearts and spirits and encourage us to rise and be strong in hope for the needs of others. Enable us to be partners in ministry of peace and justice in this world of darkness. Bring your light and power to us, Lord. Today we lift up our graduates, Becca, Jamie, and Melody. May you guide their paths and hold them close in all of their life, for all of their lives. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we lift up
Tim Cotton, Rose Little, Mary Jo Kuhn.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Lauren Formant, Henry J., Mark Nelson.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
And our graduates.
And those we now silently lift in our hearts. All of this we pray in the name of our friend and our teacher, Jesus, the one who taught us to pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Please join me in our closing hymn, Blessed Be the Tie That Binds. May God's blessing rest on each one of you now. May God's light shine on you and make your path clear. May hope carry you through the challenging times and gratitude be your response when life is good. May your days be filled with curiosity and adventure, and may you discover the incomparable joy of living lives that bring honor and glory to God. Let us all now go in peace. Amen. Congratulations to our seniors. Are we unmuted? No, we're not unmuted.
You have to unmute your own.
Okay, let's unmute ourselves so we can speak.
How do you get on the big thing so you can see everybody?
I don't know. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Down near the bottom.
Got it. There we go. I wish we could see everybody.
If you hit the little thing with all the little squares, you will be able to see everyone.
I don't have that. We're out of the size of
the Master Gay, it was.
Yes, who's speaking?
One is. It's a beautiful service you hear.
Participant
who has
the most dominant.
Say it again, Helen.
I said it was a beautiful service, but you didn't warn us we needed tissues. I think I cried through half the service.
I know. I still cry, even on video, with the morning cry.
Yes. I can't get through that song without crying.
Well,
it is so. Good to see our seniors today.
Hi, Jamie.
Hi.
I saw Edison. There's Addison.
That is Mary Jo. That is not Addie. That is Becca.
Yeah, we're on Addison's Chromebook.
Sorry, Joe.
For our seniors that are still on the line, can we have a minute? Becca, will you tell us a little bit about when you're going to school, when do you leave, and what's going on?
I'm going in August, sure. I haven't really said if we're actually going.
No. Where? I don't want the picture. I want everybody's picture on.
I'm working at Durbin's all summer. See her. Come get ice cream and see her smiling face.
We will be coming by to see your smiling face sometime in 1 and 2.
We'll be at the driveway.
Let's see, is Melody on? I saw them earlier. Possibly the Kings have dropped off. What how about Jamie? Is Jamie on?
Yes. Yeah, I'm on.
Jamie, tell us what's going on with you.
So right now I'm still living in Kent. I'm working at Target up in Stowe. I had a couple job interviews, but I didn't get any of them. So I'm gonna take a year off, and then I'm gonna start applying for jobs next year, or I might go back and get my master's. I haven't decided yet.
Very good. And you're going to sub teach, are you?
Possibly, yeah. I'm hoping to sub at a couple places. We'll see. I don't know. With school's kind of being iffy going back, I don't know exactly what I'm doing yet.
Very good. I don't see Kings. Are there any announcements? Oh, I see Mary Jo. Is it good to see your face, Mary Jo?
Yeah, hi, Mary Jo.
My oxygen.
What oxygen? Oh, she has not.
Does anyone have any announcements for the good of the group?
Can I say something?
Yes.
I want to thank Georgia and Carl for letting me plant some milkweed for the butterflies on their land down the street. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Welcome.
Thank you.
You're
welcome.
Well, I want to thank Georgia for being our liturgist and Nancy for being our organist today. And of course, Becky for every week tirelessly hosting our service for us and moving forward.
Yes, thank you, Becky.
Yeah.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Becky.
And to our seniors, we are looking forward to seeing you in person a little later this afternoon.
Looking forward to seeing all you guys too.
Bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Bye. God bless you.
Yeah.